this market.
This is Sky News Business, Australia's business channel. The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.
Good evening and welcome to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Chris Gray. On tonight's property edition of Your Money, Your Call, how many homes in Australia are worth more than their original purchase price? What are the chances that your property has doubled in value, and what are the chances that maybe it's fallen? And which are the areas to buy in and which are the areas to avoid to increase your chances of making a profit? Also on tonight's show, what are the best performing capital cities for capital growth this year and which are the worst? With so much mining activity taking place, how are regional markets performing in these areas? Now, joining us on our panel of experts tonight is Charles Tarby, CEO and Chairman of Century 21, and Graham Mirabito, CEO of RP Data. So if you've got a question about what's happening to our property markets around Australia, or anything to do with how to buy or sell properties, then give us a call on 1300 30 34 35, or if you prefer, send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. Welcome to the show, and welcome to you guys.
Okay.
Now, Charles, I'm sure there's no one that hasn't heard of Century 21, but just in case there is, can you tell us a bit about the firm and what you cover?
Yes, you always always look after our promotion. We don't have to do any promotion with Chris. Chris, it's a wonderful organisation that is global in its perspective and its way in which it reaches out to people, not just from an internet basis, but actually existing in 63 countries around the world. I had the good fortune in the mid-90s to secure the Australasian region and purchased it off the US parents, so it's 100% owned, and it's an Australian-driven business. And so, but we connect still internationally with all of these regions. And with Asia-Pacific, there are some 3,200 Century 21 offices down the line, and that's a very, very important part of the process when we do business in Australia.
And for viewers wanting to call in with questions, it's not just the sales side, it's property management as well and finance?
Yeah, we have a substantial property management database, not just from a direct company point of view in the many, many thousands, but also from the franchisees base. You know, there are over 100,000 properties managed within there. So we get a lot of stats. We operate in real time. That's a great thing. And with Graham's business operating also both in real time and historical data, we have a tremendous combination. When Graham's figures are coming out, we're actually feeling the pain just prior to when Graham's figures come out, and then we put the two together and we get a great perspective of what's going on in real estate in Australia.
Great, and that's a good link into you, Graham. We've had Rismark on here quite a few times. Do you want to explain exactly what RP Data does and obviously the link with Rismark as well?
Sure. Rismark's one of our strategic partners, so the index that we release every month and the one we release today is the RP Data Rismark Index. But RP Data is the largest property information and property data analytics company in Australia. We've got the largest database of property. More than 70% of real estate agents use RP Data. About 80% of all the property on the market got there through research with RP Data. So the largest provider to the mortgage finance industry as well for data and analytics.
Yeah, so obviously all the banks are using you. Now, what's the prime reason for them accessing the data? What are they trying to find out from that? Is it what's happening in the future, what's happening in the past, or what's something worth exactly at this point in time?
Yeah, there's a multitude of things, and we're sort of right through the whole life cycle in Charles's business. A real estate agent to list your property needs to have the information around what you're competing against in the market as you bring your property to market, what recently sold. And then when the property is about to be valued, we provide the data to the valuers, and in fact we manage the instructions of the valuers to go out on behalf of the banks to value that property. And then they use our analytics to as a compliance check to see how that valuation or the information that's coming in stacks up against our data. We value everything in Australia every week.
Right, okay. And we'll go into that in a second. Mm. And it's probably a good jump back to you, Charles. Do you want to explain, say, from the salesperson's perspective, when they're going out on a sales call, so I say I want to sell my property,
yeah.
How are you guys using RP Data and why is it that important?
And I think it's an amazing story, RP Data. When I was first in real estate in the early 70s, when we needed information on property, you'd go down to council and you'd pay a small fee and you'd get access to a thick book, various streets, and you have
it's
to
It's about
flick
a year out of date.
And then the microfiche, which was a great advancement then. We allowed to purchase that and still start to look. But I've watched because RP Data, I remember RP Data when they were cutting out paper clippings in back factories of Queensland and sticking them all in books and then trying to put them into computers and trying to build their business. Then the gentleman, Ray Catlin, who was the founder and probably the foremost authority in that area, who did in fact found RP Data, taking your story away from
that. It's good.
And when we go out, like recently I had to do an appraisal for a property. It was just a quick thing for a particular customer of ours, and they asked if I would go down there. I rang Graham, actually. It was on the Easter weekend. I said, look, I need an AVM. I need information on this property. And he just tap, and just a few moments later, there was this wonderful presentation. It showed me the demographics of the area. When I went out to see the people, they said, what sort of buyers do you think we'll get? And I said, let's have a look at the cultures that are here, and let's have a look at what prices they may pay.
And so you could look really intelligent
all of it.
Just from getting the RP data.
Well, that's very nice of you to say that, too. But it was just incredible. And I stood in that property and I thought, wow, you know how far things have come, and the ability, and this is what the great thing is that buyers and sellers, when they really want to know what's going on, they can find that information out. The difference between what they might find and what the agent understands is the agent is in it all of the time, but they can find out so much information. I think the educated buyer and the educated seller, courtesy of organisations such as RP Data, make everybody's life a lot easier.
Because certainly when you go and style a property, then you need to style it to the demographic that's actually going to be buying it.
And that was exactly what was happening with this particular property. These people had an ambition to go to a certain level. I said, if you go to that level, let me just show you what you're competing against. And it very quickly became apparent to me that if they went there, they were actually going to overcapitalise fairly quickly.
Yeah. Now, Graham, RP Data's come out with this new equity report, which sounds an amazing thing. Can you explain exactly what it's all about?
Sure. Well, because what we do is we value every property every week, every residential property, through our automatic algorithms. And as Charles said, we go out there and we're collecting data in real time. So the government data records come through 3 months later, but we're collecting data in real time from real estate agents, from the lending community. And what the equity report was all about was looking back on when people first bought their house or their unit, and what is it worth today, and therefore what equity have you delivered. So it was quite a big task to do that, and so we've gone back right to the first date of the property that you own right now as to when you purchased it.
Okay, and what's the extraordinary result that you're finding out of it? Like, is it all good or is it bad?
Well, it's like any asset investment. There's good and there's not so good. I think what the big message here is that it's a lot better than it is worse, and it's I guess not too many surprises. Well, what we're talking about here is that more than 92% of Australians have got positive equity in their property since the beginning of the GFC, which is the worst time we've really had on record for property. And about 3.3% of properties have got negative equity since they were first purchased, and about 7.7% since the GFC. So it's certainly gotten worse since the GFC, but that's a hell of a lot of people have got a lot more positive equity than what they had. And I guess more importantly, 45% of people have doubled their money in property since they purchased.
So basically with all these people, and there's a lot of kind of media going on about it, that property is going to kind of crash 40 or 50%, and there's obviously a minority of people saying that, but if they sold their properties today for those valuations, assuming they're pretty much on the market, then they're going to have positive cash in the bank account afterwards.
Correct.
And so why sell, effectively?
Yeah, and I guess one of the things we brought out today with our index release is the total return of property. If you didn't own that property you're in, you'd be out renting. So what is the total value that you've actually accumulated in the fact that you're not having to pay rent? And so the total return, if you like, on the property if you're a homeowner is quite positive.
Yeah, because I thought that was really interesting in the report as well, because for a lot of people then they're always comparing the share market and the property market and say, property only grew, say, 0% or so, but they do forget that you're actually getting 4 or 5% rents. Yeah. Sure, you've got a mortgage, but if you're paying cash or you've paid off your mortgage, you're getting 4 or 5% return, so it's still a reasonable return, even in a flat market.
Correct.
The application is obviously not the same in total everywhere, as Graham and you know, and Chris, you talk about renting properties in upmarket areas because it is a lot cheaper in terms of renting than it might be to actually pay for a large mortgage. But the reality is that people out there, they talk about the bubble, and again we've mentioned how many times this bubble has come up. If you didn't buy, if you didn't ride the whole cycle of real estate, if you go back your 10 or 15 or 20 years and you said to those people who owned property 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, look, would you have not bought the property? And they all tell you they would have bought 10 if they could have. And you just see it
and
all of the time.
History keeps repeating. It's like yes. Your parents, your grandparents. It just carries on going.
Prices go up, prices come down, and that's part of it. I mean, you talk about the negative equity. I mean, US has had 38% negative equity since the middle of 2005 when they peaked, and the UK has had 28% negative equity. And they're still calling a bubble here in Australia, and we're still sitting between 6 and 7 in parts of Australia. So yeah,
the laws of supply and demand sit on all the asset classes, and property was not immune, but... It's very easy when outside of Australia, look at Australia and say it looks like a property bubble if you haven't taken the time to understand just how the country is driven, and that is that, you know, most people live in our capital cities. Two largest equate to 55% of the population. We've got the biggest baby boom for 40 years, so the supply is not enough for the demand.
And you mentioned that there's only something like 3.7% of properties that are actually in negative equity. Are there specific areas or price points that's more likely to be with those ones, and is it more likely to be people that have bought in the last year or two, for instance?
Yeah, that's for sure. Since the GFC, the number that are in negative equity is over 7%, and it's clear that areas of Queensland and Western Australia have fared more poorly than others. So there are certain areas where you've got a bigger drop, and it tends to be those areas that also overheated. So when you have a look at the GFC coming through when Australia was at its peak, and overall the country dropped about 3% for the first 18 months in value in property. But during that, and straight after that time, we had a fair amount of growth. But some areas, Queensland, Melbourne as well, grew at like 12 or 15%, and that's just too much growth. So what you're seeing is a softening and a correction of that market.
And so really that drop in net equity is really just a temporary thing anyway, because effectively they bought at the peak. And I think the tip of the week that we've got later on will actually talk about this, that if yes. You're in very volatile markets and you suddenly get, say, 50% growth over a few years, if you buy right at that top, the chances are it's going to fall off at some point, and sure, it's negative equity, but then it goes back again.
Well, I think also, Chris, one of the things that underpins Australian real estate, economically people will talk in different language than real estate practitioners will, but the one thing that we notice is that I don't know of anybody who, if they didn't have to sell their home for less than what they bought it for, they wouldn't. And I think that's the difference. They hold on to their properties, and the percentage of sales usually calculated also includes high price properties, which tend to distort some of the figures when it comes to it, because people will pay 10 or 15 or 20 million in some parts of Sydney, and it's pretty hard to place a value on something like that. How do you really place the value? And when they do sell, if something goes wrong, it gets sold for a substantially lower amount than that. And it does have an impact on those figures, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And if you just have a look at over the last 12 months, property values have dropped around 3%. But the top 20% that Charles is talking about, you're talking drops of 5.5% across the country, which means that it's almost twice as big a drop.
Because if you get the beach suburbs, say like a Palm Beach or something, where an average property might be, say, 10 million or something, and suddenly no one's buying, it's then at 5 million. And then suddenly the market returns, and then maybe it's going to go back to its value. Like one minute it's the worst suburb, and then it's the best suburb because it's going to double in value.
It's also volume. Yeah. There's just not a lot of people around. They can afford
well,
that.
Well, the bonus is not there. I mean, that's the reality. That's true. The executive bonuses aren't there. I was speaking to a gentleman today who's in that area of business, and the bonuses are not there. The margin calls are still kicking in, and there are some people still suffering out there.
And another thing that people are arguing about is obviously affordability, and saying that Sydney's the seventh or the sixth most expensive place in the world. I always argue, well, it's the best place, so it should be the most expensive, and so it's cheap. But is there anything wrong if Sydney was the most expensive place in the world? Does that mean anything?
Well, you know, it does come down to affordability, as you said, and when you look at affordability right now, well, we've had about 300 to 400 basis points drop in interest rate. We've had inflation at 3.2, but real wages are probably up 4 or 5%. So, in fact, it is probably better off now than what you were 2 years ago. Yeah. But if you're going to live in a highly popular city, then you expect prices to be higher, as is New York and London.
Now, we're going to be back in just a minute with Tip of the Week and more questions and ideas on property.
Wouldn't it be great to have a faster, smarter, better way to check any share, any sector, any industry, and know at a glance what to buy, sell, or hold? Welcome to VectorVest Australia. VectorVest ranks the shares you choose on a simple 0-2 scale for value, safety, and timing. VectorVest gives you clear, decisive buy, sell, or hold signals for any share, updated every day. VectorVest makes it easy to go with the winners, avoid the losers, and strengthen your portfolio over time.
If you want some accurate insight to the market, go to the program. It's all there.
It's all right here at VectorVest.com.au. Visit VectorVest.com.au right now to analyze any share free. VectorVest, the faster, smarter, better way to get your portfolio back on track.
Welcome back to the program. Tonight we're joined by Charles Tarby from Century 21 and Graham Mirabito from RP Data. If you've got a question about what's happening to our property markets around Australia or anything to do with how to buy or sell properties, then give us a call at 1300 30 34 35 or send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. And before we get back to our panel, our property tip of the week. And this week's tip is, slow and steady often wins the race. When you try and get wealthy from investing in property or any other asset, there's always the temptation to try and make a fortune overnight, but it always comes with some risk. In the good times, there's plenty of people boasting about how much money they've made from picking the market or from buying and renovating. And often it's those same people that complain in the tougher times that their properties have substantially dropped in value. Now, wherever there's excess profits, there's normally excess risks as well. So buying in the safe and blue chip suburbs may mean that you can't bag a bargain when you purchase, but they may not double overnight, but often they'll give you consistent returns no matter what's happening in the market. And with that, often you'll win the race in the long run. Now, to understand more about any of my tips of the week, they'll come from my book, The Effortless Empire. You can download it absolutely free. Just go to yourempire.com.au. Now, Charles, just jumping to you, they always say good properties always sell in good suburbs. Is that always right, and is that at all price points, or is it kind of with a pinch of salt at times?
Well, it really does depend on the marketplace. You know, there are hundreds and hundreds of different marketplaces in Australia. But if a property's priced correctly, if it's presented well, if it's great location with all the services, it's going to have a much better chance of selling than other properties that don't have those services. But when you get into coastal areas in the last few years, they've had a pretty tough time all round, even when you've got good properties, because there's no money available or people don't have their spare money to throw around. So in that instance, it doesn't apply, but in general instances, it does apply that if the property's the right property, well presented, well located, well positioned, the whole thing, it'll get a really good run right now, particularly now.
And obviously you've got offices all around Australia. Would it be
Papua New Guinea?
Sorry, yeah, Papua New Guinea. Just in case anyone's tuning in, I'm not sure if we get there or not. Generally around the cities where there's typically more money, maybe more jobs, is it generally a safer market for your agents there or compared to kind of going more regionally?
Well, there are some great regional centres. So you talk about places like Orange and Goulburn and Bathurst, those like in talking Sydney, or you're talking Mildura and other parts of the country, there's some tremendous opportunities there. And I talk to those offices regularly and they're doing very, very well. But you'll talk to some country areas and the growth is just not going to be there for a few years. It runs behind Sydney or runs behind the Brisbane or Melbourne, the capital cities, and it runs well behind. And then when it does catch up, it catches up just a bit slow and stops a lot quicker than the other markets. So I think the regional areas are great, but the best areas are always going to be where the thousands upon thousands of home buyers will be, because you'll always have somebody who'll want to buy your home.
So going back to the supply and demand, there's plenty of demand, there's no more houses being built, so
yes,
that's
keeping
the prices up. Yeah. Now, Graham, you brought along with you your August figures. When it comes to capital cities, which is the best one for August so far?
Well, Darwin has been the only one recording positive growth at 0.2% on the August figures. They're the indicative. And Sydney comes in second at zero growth. So the rest of
it's
the
one time it's actually nice to be zero.
Yeah. So I guess what we're seeing is that the country's still in a fairly soft landing, but it hasn't accelerated as far as the reductions are concerned. And Darwin's certainly poking its head up there, not just only on capital growth, but also on rental yield.
Right, okay. Mm. And what's typically happening with rents at the moment?
Well, as we were sort of talking about earlier, the demand is there, so people have to live somewhere, and there's not enough new properties being built. So yields are pretty good. Darwin again is showing the best yields and the best growth, often because it's there's quite a lot of growth happening in the city itself, and people don't necessarily live there, so they actually buy a lot of investment property. So there's quite a good dynamic going on in Darwin.
And are you finding the same thing, Charles?
Yeah, the vacancy factors are again, you know, way down. We the one particular company I manage directly, we have about 8,200 landlords in marketplaces across Sydney, Melbourne, and Perth. The vacancy factor across that vast number of properties is just over 2%. And the reason for that is that some of them are commercial, industrial, and some of them are holiday areas. If they weren't there, I reckon it would even be much, much lower than that. What we're also finding is that with interest rates stable, and you know, they keep talking about them coming back, and we talked about this last time, we still think there might be a chance. And I like it where they are. I think maybe a quarter percent might even be better, but I like it where it is because it gives us an opportunity. If the world economy struggled, the Reserve Bank have got, you know, 475 basis points, is it now still in the barrel to shoot, whereas other economies are zero rates or 1%. So we're still in a great position. But with those rates coming down, with salaries going up, in all of my years of business, I've never had an employee come in and say, I'd like to take salary reduction. And I was talking to some guys from Grant Thornton about that today. They actually always come in and ask for more. And as they ask for more, and as the prices have started to stable, and as the interest rates are coming down, these lines are starting to cross over. And tenants are out there looking at things saying, you know what, it's going to be cheaper for me to have a mortgage than to rent a property. And when they start seeing that, I think then we're going to start to see the market moving again in that direction.
And that's just all part of the cycle, just moving
very
it
much
on
so.
Very naturally,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, very much so. And gosh, you know, we talked about unemployment low. Something like, I read the other day, that was a $29 billion investment. Was it Textron or one of those companies, again in Australia, in the mining sector? There's so much investment, and all of these things are there. And we talked about mortgage stress before, and I think that might be an interesting point we might cover a little later on, because that's an area we should talk about and explain that it's actually not quite as bad in some areas as people might think.
And talking about the rents and the vacancy, you already explained that some of them might be commercial properties, but even if there is, say, 1 or 1.5%, what is typically wrong with those properties? Is it they're overpriced, they're really badly looked after by the landlord or something like that?
I think in the commercial world, and I experience this firsthand because I have investments in that area, it's more so the fact that there is a really poor level of confidence with a lot of business people, small business people and SMEs in Australia. There's not a lot of confidence, and they're still sort of sitting on the fence. But whereas when you look at the figures for the general public, they're doing pretty well. So
for pretty much residential, there's virtually no vacancy, really, is
there? Well, it's very hard to get properties for rent. In a lot of areas, you're still seeing people lining up for properties or having open homes on properties.
Because a lot of the properties that we buy are pretty much unrenovated, and our clients come in and see them and just say, oh, look, we're going to have to renovate. And we say, no, you can renovate in a few years. And they can't believe that people will live in these places and say, this is good condition property, it's clean.
That's right.
You want to see some of the other stuff that's around, and people still rent it. Because there's nothing around. It's cheap.
No, there isn't. And I experienced this just recently with my son looking at some property to rent when he goes to study in the city. We said, what about talking about buying something, Joe? You know, we'll have a look. And all of a sudden, the mortgage that we would get would be almost the same as rent. He's saying, well, you know, this is a really, really strange situation. And then we're talking about inner city Sydney.
And especially if you then turn it into, a rental property, and then you get the tax back as well,
correct,
which then reduces the difference, it's
correct,
almost no difference.
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. Now, Graham, obviously a lot of people are saying in the economy, obviously mining's going pretty well these days. What's actually happening in the mining areas around there to kind of capital growth and rents?
Yeah, well, we're seeing a lot of growth there in areas like Karratha and Port Hedland and those sorts of areas. And, of course, I guess it's the same old story. If it's high yielding and high growth, then typically there comes with it risk. And something to grow that fast means that it's responding to the fact that there's a mining boom on. But similarly, if you've got to be aware of global factors there that could shrink that, and of course things could go the other way. So, but there definitely is very strong growth in those areas.
You can't just turn up at Karratha expecting to get a hotel room. if you just flew in, so I'll go, it just doesn't happen. A 50 square metre apartment will rent for $1,500 a week. So it's really quite bizarre there, and that's going to continue.
Yeah.
There are some major companies, Finbar out of Perth, interconnected with Monadophilus Engineering. They've got a major development they want to do in there, and they will pre-sell pretty much all of those properties very, very quickly.
Same thing's happening in southwest Queensland, you know.
And how well do you need to be connected? Say for me sitting in Sydney, who doesn't know anything about mining whatsoever, am I going to be the last, if I go and buy an investment there, am I the last one? So suddenly the mine shuts down, everyone moves out of town, yeah. And I'm suddenly holding my property.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah.
I think this often comes down to, we were talking earlier about how much more information there is around. And there certainly is a lot for consumers to get themselves informed. But the empowerment sits with the professional. So you really have to find your local real estate agent, your local valuer, who live in the district. They understand the rise and fall, they understand the drivers, and they'll provide you the best advice. So they get the two key professionals.
You'd look good in one of those hats with corks, they get your pan out, you go up and try and get some gold out of the ground to rescue your investment. We've got some offices in the mining areas, and I was chatting to the owners of the Gladstone office recently, and they've got subdivisions and they're looking for more subdivisions, anything that they can get their hands on, because those areas are just flying, absolutely flying.
But I guess the good thing is if you've got a local agent in that area, they're always keen to sell your property anyway. So if they see the boom's going to finish, then they're happy to sell
it
for you.
But they know what's going on, Graeme, so they know what's happening. They're seeing it.
They do it every day, as you said earlier. You know, a lot of us like to feel, you know, we've got the information at our fingertips, but you really have to get back to your local professional when it comes to property.
Yeah. And just in general, obviously kind of coming into the summer months now, what's likely to happen with the property market in terms of supply of properties coming for sale and buyers around?
Yeah, it's interesting. The summer months are, in fact, around about now, coming into summer, is the highest listing time. In other words, most properties come onto the market. But the biggest sale month, actually, in Australia is around March. I think what we see also is that it's about the consumer confidence, right? So we see a lot of properties on the market. There's probably 30% more properties on the market this time of this year compared to the same time last year. Sales volume is probably down about 17%, so there's quite a bit of property on the market. Consumer confidence hit a pretty much an all-time low, but it's had a little bounce back in September. And that's normally your lead indicator for about 6 months into the property sales market. So I will be looking with a lot of interest at February, March. That's really when you'll see the highest peak in sales, but listings are certainly, this is the time they all come on.
Are your listings coming up?
Yeah, actually we looked at the figures today because we gather information daily, and the number of listings is up substantially, particularly in New South Wales. So that's poised, ready to go. It's almost like as though we're sitting on the crest of a wave and it just won't break. All the indicators are there. And I think it's a matter of what you said, Grant. The consumer confidence is at an all-time low.
Because say if you've got the same amount of buyers and you've got more listings coming on, does that then effectively reduce the price because there's more properties to choose from? Or when there's more properties, does that automatically kind of get more buyers interested?
There's more time for negotiation. There's not that urgency where people go and, you know, pay silly money. Sometimes they do at auction, they get a little bit carried away. And sometimes they pay a little bit more for a property than they should.
Now, one question is with the various different levels of the market. What do you find at the moment, say, with the top end versus, say, the lower end?
The top end's really, really having a tough time.
Yeah.
I talked to the offices in the lower northern suburbs, say, of Sydney, and they say their marketplace, if they can get properties for sale between 800 and 1.8 to 2 million, they will sell. When you start getting up over those ranges there, it's a very difficult marketplace. So agents that typically operate in those marketplaces are probably having a very difficult time right now. So that's an area that I think will suffer for a little bit longer until that confidence comes back. And it's not so much the confidence as much for people in that marketplace. So you'll get those executives or husband and wife teams, both professional, working, and they have not been getting those bonuses. They're not going to get the bonuses for a little while, and it's changed the world. It's changed the world for them.
So certainly depends where you're invested, and certainly the price of your properties. Joining me on the panel of experts tonight is Charles Tarby from Century 21 and Graeme Mirabito from RP Data. If you've got a question or want to join the discussion, number to call 1300 30 34 35 or send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. We'll be back in just a minute.
You graduate, get a job, which becomes a career. You move to the coast, Start a new hobby. There's a whirlwind romance. A big white wedding. A baby on the way. Twins. You need a bigger house, which comes at a bigger price. You retire. Then you really start living. AMP is Australia's favourite for financial advice. So we can help you handle whatever life throws at you.
True happiness can take time. 3 days until the music festival. 6 months to grow another 3 centimetres. Cracking 26 down all day long. But there are some shortcuts. The Maggi range offers all new 10-minute marinades. Enjoy full marinade flavour in just 10 minutes. Not overnight. Maggi. Happiness made simple.
On special this week at Woolworths.